Well, you. So this talk will be about the all or nothing phenomenon. It's a sharp statistical, let's say, phase transition. We're going to the details, and specifically, we're going to discuss about hopefully see what I did here. Yeah, the sparseness of PCA, and this is joint work with Jonathan Niles-Witt from NYU as well. Okay, so let me just jump into it. So what is the motivation here? So what is the kind of generic introduction? So a nice and attractive thing about high dimensional statistics and high dimensional statistical models is that they undergo phase transitions. And you know, this is a term borrowed from physics. It just corresponds to the idea that like small changes sometimes in the parameters of the model really change structurally the model itself in a macroscopical way. And you know, what will be a canonical phase transition to keep in mind here is what you know, it's called also BPP phase transition in random matrix theory. And this is the idea, you know, like that you can, you know, take a model of PCA in the statistical sense, so the principal component analysis. And okay, let's see together what this model is. So there exists an unknown signal that is sampled uniformly in the sphere in p dimensions. And then there exists a p by p matrix which has IID standard Gaussian entries. And we're observing y, which is just beta beta transpose, so the rank one spike generated by beta, appropriately scaled, let's say square root of a constant times the dimension plus the Gaussian noise. And the goal is, given access to y, you want to infer beta or beta beta transpose, let's say here. You can cover, you can take the MMSA, and you can say, okay, let's take the high dimensional limit. So as the dimension grows to infinity. And then there's a transition happening exactly at lambda equal one. So lambda is again a constant here. And what happens is that if lambda is less than one, the limit in MSC is what we say trivial. And what do we mean by trivial? It means that it matches the performance of a trivial estimator, which is the performance of the zero estimator, right? So it's a unit norm, beta or beta beta transpose, if you want here. On this. So essentially, you know, you are essentially as good as you were with zero observations. And what happens at lambda bigger than one is that you jump to something strictly less than one in a also continuous way at one. So, you know, pictorial here, if you try to just, you know, see what the limit MMSC is, it's like trivial and then it goes down in a decreasing way. And this is a generic picture. Like we see it in many models, and this is kind of traditional the high dimensional statistics picture. And you know, the question is it always the case? Is it always the case that the limit in MSC is like, okay, a continuous curve, or let's say, quote-unquote, smooth curve? And the all-or-nothing phenomenon is kind of, if you want a refutation of this, or kind of a strong refutation of this in generic contexts, and there is cases where this phenomenon, this transition is very sharp. So consider a variant of the PCA model, which is, if you want, a very sparse variant of it, which is known as the K-sparse PCA model, when K, the sparsity is like sublinear in the dimension. So consider the case where the vector beta here is on the sphere as before, but it's, you know, it has only k non-zero entries, and for simplicity, let's say it takes two values. So it's either zero or one over square root k at every point, and exactly k of them. And then the same model as well as before, Gaussian noise, and y beta beta transpose plus w. You need, you know, you cannot enter, the transition doesn't happen now, of course, at the square root p. You need to appropriately define a different dimension here, but lambda is again a constant. So what's the all or nothing phenomenon? That if you consider the MMSE here, there is a jump again at one, but a very strong jump. So at lambda less than one, you have a performance of a trivial estimator. Okay. But at lambda bigger than one, this becomes like vanishing. So this becomes like the performance of as good as it gets, at least at this scale of things. And, you know, just to remember what we had before is like a transition like this. And the moment you go sublinear in P, this goes, you know, like this. And also, you know, let me tell you a little bit about who has proven this result. So initially it has been established by John Cynthia that attended the conference and also Nicola Materia 2020, and we later strengthen it with John. And okay, so this is the thing I would like you to keep in mind, that there is like these two different pictures, at least these two different pictures happening here. Again, you know, this is in subcontext with what we understand about happening in regular PCA and in many other models as well, which are denser in nature. And you know, a small review here. So the first case that we saw this phenomenon happening is in sparse linear regression, actually. So it's a little bit more complicated context. And we established it in the case where k is little of square p, which you can say it seems a little bit strange, But you know, this is kind of a technicality. We believe it's again happening in the whole sublinear regime, but we didn't prove it. So the history is that we with David Gamanik at 2017, we proved it for the MLE. So if you want the special estimator, the max collection estimator regression, and we conjecture that it's happening generally. And later with Galerius and Chamics, we established it at 2019. And then actually the following year or 2 years, like interestingly, there was a bump into surface transition and people started realizing, including in this conference, people started realizing that this phenomenon is actually happening generally in sublinear sparsity settings, or at least we expect it in many settings to be happening. For example, in Bernoulli group testing, so some Truong and co-authors established it in the polylogarithmic regime in P, in sparse PCA, Cynthia, Zone and Nicolas Macri established it again, K sublinear here, but bigger than P to a large, let's say, 12 or 13, if I'm right here. General Leslier models, random graph matching, and you can see always that there is, you know, there is kind of some technicality. So there is a technicality, like, you know, you cannot enter what we expect to be the whole sublinear regime, but we kind of believe this. Random graph matching is a little bit of a different business. That's why there's not this. But, you know, this kind of brings the question, what is causing this surface transition? So why, like, there is such a discrepancy? And what I want to do in this talk, really briefly, is I want to tell you about a special case of this phenomenon in some recent work with John in the model of sparse tensor PCA. As we will see, it's like a generalization, let's say, of the sparse PCA model I mentioned before. For two reasons. I mean, you know, if someone can ask why I don't do this for sparse regression, where, you know, the initial thing was established, it's just much more complicated, let's say. Even if it's the first example, this is much cleaner. And the sparse tensor PCA model is like as before, so you observe Y, but it has a tensor form that it decomposes again as signal plus noise. And your signal is a T tensor power of a hidden vector. So for T equal to is the matrix case. And again, you know, appropriately rescale it and you add Gaussian IID elements per tensor. And also besides the tensor, it's also a sparse spike. Okay, and that's the sparsity and the sparse tensor form. For T equal two, that's the model I present you in the second slide. So what we did in this work is we established the Dolonite phenomenon actually to the best of my knowledge first time for all the sublinear sparsity regime. And this improved over the result I sent before. By Cynthia and Nicotri from in the case of T equal two. And K is at least P12 or 13. And why I want to mention this is because we kind of understood a generic equivalence here for the Dolonite phenomenon. So we understood that the surface transition was happening exactly if a simple, if you want, probabilistic condition takes place. So we boil it down to a relative entropy calculation, if you want. And I think that's why I want to communicate the development in that direction. Okay, so I will just jump into the details here and tell you, you know, what we understood here. Okay, so the way we understood it is we understood a little bit of a more generic class that, you know, all these PCA models I described take place, which is the Gaussian additive model. So what's a Gaussian additive model? I mean, you may hear it in a very different names in the past. It's just you take a signal and you add Gaussian noise. And, you know, so it's, okay, so what is more formally Gaussian additive model for us? So it's like before, there is some generality. So you are again on the sphere. This is the where your signal lives. But there is a discrete, a finite subset of the sphere that I will allow this prior, it will be my prior supported on. So let's say this is S, you know, a finite subset. And beta is a uniformly chosen vector along this subset. And then what happens is, you know, I add noise, you know, I have some noise, I add the Gaussian entries and I just rescale beta and I observe Y. And I want to see from Y whether I can ever double. And okay, so that's the whole model. That's why I kind of like it. Like it doesn't hide things. And just, of course, there is this S, right? What is this S? Okay, you can say, is this the PCA model? This is simpler, it's vector plus noise. It of course is though, because you know, you can appropriately define this S to have whatever structure you want. So like, you know, you can define S, for example, to contain the PCA or the Rademacher PCA. Where we know, for example, that the transition is not all or nothing. There is this BPP phase transition I described in the first slide, also for this model. How do you do this? You know, you just take your vectors that you want to define the rank one spike of, just the hypercube vectors. And then, you know, you create in P squared dimension now the matrix, VV transpose, and you vectorize it. And then you just choose beta to be the vectorized form of VP transpose, and this is exactly in one-to-one correspondence with the random market PCA model. Of course, you can do it in sparse PCA. So you can impose a condition here, which is K sparse, and it's like, takes, three values, let's say. So that's the random market version as I mentioned before, again, in P squared dimension, that's fine. And you can do also tensor PCA. You just need to go to P to the T dimension, and you just consider the corresponding vectorized tensor. And, this is a good thing because this brings a contrast here. So this is not sharp. This doesn't have an MMSE transition, which is sharp. This is kind of, come to the point of like what makes the transition sharp or not, at least in this context, like it will hopefully clarify this part. And so this is the Gaussian IV model. Hopefully it's clean. There is this hidden subset S, and that's kind of it. So what's the all-or-nothing phenomenon? So the all-or-nothing phenomenon is clean in this way. So you can define it. What would it mean that this Gaussian IV model obtains the all-or-nothing phenomenon? It means that as you increase the SNR, at some point the MMSE will jump from 1 to 0, basically. So as you it will become, there is a critical lambda C, which now it may depend on two things, N and the S, that's all. That for any epsilon constant, the following transition happens. If you are a little bit below the lambda critical, the limit MMSE is trivial. Like you cannot beat the random guess. You have no information. But if you are a little bit above the lambda critical, this becomes vanishing. And the question is, when is this the case? When do we expect such a sharp transition to be happening for the limit in MMSE for a Gaussian active model? And you say, right, it's at a level of constant. This is a kind of, you're new to this transition. This is important. So like you are, yeah. Okay, so the theorem is as follows. So I need some notation. So let's just denote for simplicity M to be the cardinality of S. So this is the, the support, the size of the support of your prior. So, the entropy, for example, of your prior, it's just, log M. So, right, so it's just that you have M points that you're choosing of. And then P sub lambda is the law of your observations at the signal denoisation lambda, and Q is just P of zero, is the Gauss, the law of Y sub zero, which, with no signal, you're just W, so it's just a standard Gaussian law. So the theorem is as follows. It's quite simple to state. All or nothing happens for a Gaussian IV model you fix. All or nothing happens at some lambda critical if and only if two conditions happen. And that's all, basically. Firstly, the transition should happen at twice the entropy of the prior. Like there is no other, up to 1/(1+L1)) there is nothing else that could obtain this transition. So this is the critical point where such an SNR, this is the SNR where transition can happen. And secondly, if you compare what you see at the observations, the distribution of your observations at 2 log m at criticality, like the distribution of the observations when this is the criticality, with the zero SNR case, they are very close in the KL distance, but not extremely close. They can be the KL divergence, the relative entropy between them can grow, but they cannot grow bigger than log m. They cannot grow faster than log m. And basically, that's it. So the all or nothing phenomenon happens at some lambda critical, if and only if lambda critical is 2 log m, and the KL divergence between the two distributions, what you see at criticality, looks, if you want, very much like what you saw at zero in an appropriate quantified form. And just a quick comment, a lot of times in the literature, for the expert here, a lot of times in the literature, you see statements like, if the KL goes to zero, then I can prove that the MMSE is trivial. This is kind of a little bit stronger. It shows that there is some room, that the KL doesn't go to zero. But still, you can get nothing. Still, you can prove that the MMSE is trivial. Okay, so let me tell you very quickly how you apply to such sparse tensor PCA. Basically, yeah. I mean, by the way, this gives you a tool, right? You have your favorite Gaussian IV model. You want to prove all or nothing phenomenon. Just prove this. So you just need to prove that the KL distribution is just a calculus exercise, or analysis, more specific exercise. So that's what we did. So we applied sparse tensor PCA. So let me quickly tell you what we did. So this is the S. which is, you know, what your matrix, the spike of the matrix would be. So, you know, just the, oh, sorry about this, the k sparse vectors, and, you know, what is m here? Well, this is just p choose k, right? You just need to choose a support here. And so, you know, the lambda critical in span tensor PCA, at least with a binary vector, would be just twice log p choose k. This should be the criticality. This would be the lambda and the criticality. And that's what we said. So this is the criticality. This is a constant. You take the t tensor power plus w for any t. Now, you don't need this to be a matrix. And for all k, which is little of p, we establish that the all or nothing phenomenon happens. So as a corollary of this result. So if lambda is less than one, this is trivial. And if lambda is bigger than one, this is finite. Okay, so this is kind of, you know, just a direct application of the result. Okay, so at the following minutes that I have, I would like to give you an idea of how we prove the other result, of how we establish the equivalence. Okay. Okay, so this is the application of the previous result, just the direct application that there is no, you know, I'm not hiding any hidden really conceptual, you know, calculations here. Okay, so let me just give you an idea of what we proved here, of how did we establish that all of that phenomenon happens if and only if. Just we'll give you also some, hopefully some intuition. Okay, so recall P sub lambda, you know, is the law of Y lambda of the observation that there's not. And, you know, M is the cardinality of S, right? So this is how many points you have in you're choosing from prior. Okay, and we want to prove that all of that phenomenon happens if and only if the KL vanishes faster than log M at criticality between, the, yeah, you understand, between the observation of criticality and zero, and lambda critical is twice the prior entropy of the prior, twice log M. Okay, so the key thing here and why this we have such a sharp characterization is the IMMC relation. So what's an IMMC relation is a very beautiful and clean and quite, you know, straightforward if you know the proof relation by Guo, Shamai, and Verdu from 2005. It really follows by integration by parts, and it's a way to actually connect the KL, the relative entropy between the YL and Y0 and the MMSE in this model, just because of the Gaussianity of the noise. And, you know, it's a relation that tells you that if you take the derivative of the KL between P and lambda Q, it's just half minus half the MMS. And this is really exact. I'm not hiding any asymptotic terms here. And, you know, what's nice, right? So if you have this thing and you know that all or nothing phenomenon happens, at least asymptotically here, then you know that this is trivial if lambda is less than lambda C and zero if lambda is bigger than lambda C. So in particular, you know that this is half minus half zero if lambda is less than lambda C and half if lambda is bigger than lambda C. So in particular, you can translate the MMSC phase transition to a derivative of the KL as a phase transition. So if you come to think about then what's happening here and you just plot the KL with respect to lambda, you know it starts at zero. So the KL between P sub zero comma Q is zero because, you know, this is P sub zero. Then you know that it should stay there the whole time until you hit lambda critical. And then it should grow with a slope half. And essentially, you know, this gives you an if and only if characterization. Admittedly, I'm passing some limits here, but it gives you an if and only if characterization for all or nothing to happen with MSE with respect to the KL. So what I'm saying here is formally, you can prove all or nothing happens at lambda critical if you want to take the limits the right way. If for any constant alpha, if you take the KL between alpha lambda critical comma Q divided by lambda critical, then this is just, you know, what it should be in the limit. So if you just plot this thing, you know, with respect to alpha, if you plot this thing, this is just zero all the way to one, and then it's half alpha minus one. And, you know, why we divide here? Because, you know, if by chain rule, if you take the derivative with respect to this, with respect to alpha, you get back here, right? So just it's a matter of chain rule. Okay, so we translate this into actually infinitely many KL conditions. So this is the first step. And then how do you translate to one of them? So let's do the quick argument. So let's see how KL between two, you know, between the distributions at two log M, you can establish this essentially thing. Well, you can consider it's coming from analytic properties of the KL. So if you consider this function, this is a non-decreasing and half Lipschitz function. This is actually an easy argument to see. So you just, you know, and you need to prove, you know, that this function has this property. So it's a non-decreasing and half Lipschitz function. This is an easy thing, and it starts at zero. So in particular, if you have this assumption, you know that alpha equal one, it's still zero in the limit. So because it's not decreasing, it should stay at zero all the way to one. And then, you know by the half Lipschitz that this is an upper bound. So your function is somewhere here. So then we just, by direct analysis, prove the lower bound. So this is kind of the way we prove the one direction. It's coming from the analytic properties of the KL. How do you prove the other thing? That if all or nothing phenomenon happens, that the lambda critical is 2 log m and the KL condition is this. Okay, so if all that phenomenon happens, this happen. And look, if you prove that lambda critical is 2 log m, then you can just come here, you know, plug in 2 log m and plug in alpha equal 1. This is becoming this quantity and this is becoming 0. So it's like if you prove that lambda critical is 2 log m, you know, essentially you are done. You have this condition also. But there is the question, you know, then why the criticality should always happen at 2 log m? Like where you have no other choice. This is happening from the following calculation. If you just compute, you know, if you have that this thing has this limit by the Lorentz phenomenon, then, you know, you can say this thing and just translate it to mutual formation by some known identity. It's just alpha over two minus the mutual formation between beta and the observation by lambda c. And then, you know, because for alpha bigger than one, the MMSE is trivial, this is really the full entropy. This is really okay. This is by definition of the mutual information. This is this, and this is essentially zero. So this is log m. So this is becoming alpha over two minus log m over lambda critical. But you knew here that this would be half alpha minus half. So by equating these two parts, you get that the only place of a criticality should be the lambda critical. Okay, I admit that's a super technical slide. I hope like some expert got something out of it. So The point is, okay, so this is, you know, kind of the simple KL condition. And let me wrap this up very quickly. Sorry for being a little bit minutes off. So this is a new sharp MMSC phase transition. So the Lorentz phenomenon, how for the people that didn't know that is to communicate this part, that there are some transitions that are sharper than we believe. And, you know, it will be some interesting things, whether these are computational as well. For example, do we expect the sharp transition in a computational sense? Approximate method passing, for example, is a good candidate. We do have some results in regression with Galen and Jamming. And I think that John, Cynthia, and Nicole McGregor have also some results in this. I think we're still, it will be a good investigation. We have a clear understanding for these Gaussian models. There are many different models that we don't. Is sublinear sparsity or discreteness crucial? I mean, I'm not sure for any of them. I would believe that this is the crucial part, but this is also something to be discussed. And finally, it depends on your background, but in random graph theory, 20 years ago, actually, there has been a big quest of trying to understand the difference between sharp and coarse phase transitions. Like with culminated with the work of Frigut and Bourguien, trying to understand, you know, what it's causing, you know, triangles to have a coarse phase transition as opposed to connectivity, for example, random graphs. I mean, I like to think, or I have this ambition that this, you know, the direction that can go in statistics in this sense, and we'll eventually get a characterization of whether the MMSE obtains such a transition or not. Okay, thank you very much, and sorry for taking a bit of time.